we usher in 2025 with yet more interesting scientific discoveries. And January's compilation was a fun one indeed. So here are 10 interesting scientific discoveries for January 2025. Happy New Year! Number 10. Space slows the brain. There are many open questions about human health in space, which are growing increasingly pressing with the push to put human boots on Mars. The bottom line is that even though we have maintained a human presence in space on space stations long term for many years, the full effects of space living on health long term are still not well understood. One area of concern is the brain, and it turns out space has a marked effect on it. It turns out you actually think slower in space. A new study at Johnson Space Center revealed that in a sampling of 25 astronauts spending time on the International Space Station, there was a pronounced slowing of cognitive abilities. It takes longer to take a cognitive test in space, though performance remains otherwise about the same in the end. Interestingly, while the astronauts recovered their normal thinking speed when they returned to Earth, it was not an instant recovery, and the effects of space on the brain persisted a bit when back on the planet. This is important for increasingly long space travel times, most notably to Mars. Mars has gravity and may be easier on the brain, but if people go to Mars and spend large amounts of time in transit in space, it has to be pointed out that cognitive abilities are extremely important in such a harsh, unbelievably remote environment when they get to Mars. Only further study into just what factors are at play in causing this effect will yield any potential ways to mitigate it. Number 9. The carnivore pollinator. One of the rarest members of the canid species, highly endangered at this point, is the Ethiopian wolf, Canis simensis. These wolves, sometimes referred to as jackals, populate the Ethiopian highland, though there are now fewer than 500 individuals left in existence. New research has shown that this mammal actually serves as a pollinator for a plant known as the Ethiopian red hot poker flower, which with a name like that you'd think you'd want to avoid it. But its nectar is really sweet and has actually been used by local people traditionally as spread for bread and as a coffee sweetener. The wolves agree that it's delicious and also lap at the nectar, which actually is thought to be the first large carnivore species known that does this, though it pays to mention that some of the bears do this, but they are omnivores like we are, and bears are diverse in themselves. The panda likes bamboo shoots, the polar bear likes meat. The Ethiopian wolves just like predominantly meat and this nectar, even though they are otherwise carnivores, and it's a plant product, which typically wolf species are not well adapted to feed on. And usually flowers don't really produce enough nectar to be satisfying for a macrofauna. But this one does, and the Ethiopian wolves love it. It also helps that the stalk of the flower is really robust, which means the wolves can get in there and lick reliably. Researchers actually observed some of the wolves visiting as many as 30 flowers in one session, and it turns out when they do that, their muzzles get covered in pollen, meaning that as they go flower to flower, they transfer that pollen, not unlike a bee, just in a radically different biology, leading to the question of whether other members of the animal kingdom are incognito pollinating in ways we previously didn't realize. Hopefully, the Ethiopian wolf can make a comeback, because pollination is definitely something that is not wise to mess with on this planet. Number 8. Hot water on Mars. More meteorite news. Water on Mars has long been a subject of study ever since we first got a close look at that planet, and it was screaming that it once had water flowing on its surface. In 2011, a Martian meteorite was discovered in the Sahara Desert in Morocco, known as Black Beauty, or NWA 7034 formally. Inside this meteorite, there was a recent discovery of a zircon crystal, very tiny, just 50 micrometers. That crystallized below the surface of Mars only to be blasted out by an impact. Zircons are very important. They happen on this planet and reveal much about the earliest history of Earth. They serve as records of sorts. But Mars has them too, and the particular type found in this meteorite only happens at hydrothermal vents that occur very near volcanic activity, causing the crystal to grow layer by layer in a characteristic way. This means that Mars's water was interacting with its volcanism and may have had a significant amount of water vapor in its atmosphere early on as a result, possibly even before it had rivers and lake systems. This sort of thing, hydrothermal vents and springs heated by volcanism, is growing increasingly important in the study of abiogenesis, with the also recent link between hot springs periodically drying out and then rehydrating with the formation of protocell walls. Add that with another recent discovery of RNA spontaneously coming out of an environmental mix of volcanic glasses, water, and chemical components, and Mars is getting very interesting indeed. Number 7. Data diamonds. It has been said that diamonds are forever, but that's not really true. They do last an insanely long period of time, at least until they get too close to a star or other means of destroying them. That said, it's actually possible to store data in a diamond with today's technology, through laser pulse encoding. And it's been shown that by making an optical disc the same volume for data as a Blu-ray in diamond, which requires much less space, you can actually store 100 terabytes of data, about 2,000 times that of a Blu-ray, and it could be stored in a diamond matrix for millions of years at roughly room temperature. This has two interesting possibilities. One is archival. This would be a step above any archival method we have for preserving images, artwork, literature, and so on that humans have produced. We can do that, as we do. But this method can do that for a very, very long-term period, and at very high quality, in a long-term medium, unlike anything else. This means we could send data diamonds out into the universe, and if they could be decoded by alien civilizations, then think of all the great artwork and literature from Earth preserving galactically, indefinitely, even if we were to go extinct. Likewise, it would be possible for alien civilizations to do this as well. And if we were able to decode it, should we ever find something like this, then we could get the collective knowledge of an alien civilization that may have existed millions of years ago, but no longer does, as a kind of SETI gift-giving of epic proportions, if not direct contact with alien civilizations, all in single tiny diamond crystals that might embed themselves in meteorites. Number 6. Chimps do better work when watched. Doing something while being watched always has an effect on someone, good or bad. Whether it's being watched by a boss or someone over the shoulder, or giving a speech to 100 people, it's different than when it's just you working on your own. It turns out it works this way for chimpanzees as well. Researchers in Kyoto recently took a group of 6 chimpanzees and put them through numerical tasks. In other words, the numbers 1 through 5 would appear on a screen in random locations, and the chimps had to touch them in numerical order and then be rewarded. Chimps can do this task, however. The test was then made more complex, with random numbers appearing that were not adjacent, and the chimps continued to get it right. Finally, a third test involved showing the numbers to the chimps, but when they pressed 1, the rest would go behind black squares, and the chimps had to remember the order of the numbers they saw to get the reward. This test was done thousands of times over several years, with varying amounts of humans watching, with the chimps knowing full well that they were there. Strangely, performance on the easiest test suffered if there were more people in the room. But the chimps actually got markedly better at the harder tasks when they knew that they had a larger audience. Humans do this as well sometimes. This is all averages. But the researchers expected the chimps to do increasingly worse due to the distraction of larger audiences. But they actually did not, and averaged something like humans. Once again, the chimps surprise us with their mental abilities. Number 5. A photo of a star in another galaxy. By far the easiest stars in the Milky Way that allow us to photograph them as physical disks instead of just point light sources are those that are about to explode, such as Betelgeuse, because they are enormous. But taking detailed pictures of stars is a function of distance as well, and resolving individual stars in other galaxies is difficult, and resolving any detail is even harder. But now it actually has been done with a star over 160,000 light years away in another galaxy, though a satellite of the Milky Way, the Large Magellanic Cloud. This star has been known for a while, known as WOH-G64, or the Behemoth Star. This monster is between 1540 and 2575 times the size of the sun, and is about to explode. Resolving the star has proven difficult, but was finally done recently at the Very Large Telescope Interferometer in Chile. Basically, four telescopes linked together to function as one giant telescope. The resolution needed is actually comparable to what you would need to resolve a single astronaut walking on the moon, though these telescopes cannot do that because of sensitivity and brightness. The moon would blow out the sensors. This star happens to be blowing out large shells of gas and dust on a very titanic level, indicating that it may be very close to a supernova, years instead of centuries. This is not guaranteed. Gigantic, unstable stars like this can do all sorts of outgassing and ejection, but if the star is indeed about to explode, then we will have taken measurements of a star just before that process unfolded, which makes the series and continued observations of the star very important in astronomy, as chances like this are extremely rare. Or it may quiet back down and not explode. We shall see. Number 4. Surviving the Red Giant Phase. One huge open question about the far future of the solar system is whether the sun will expand out enough to swallow and destroy Earth, or merely leave it as a cinder. But for planets like Venus, the situation is basically hopeless. It will not survive. But maybe Earth has a better chance than we thought. A planet has been found by JWST in orbit of the white dwarf WD-0310-688, about 35 light years from Earth. The planet is huge, about three times the mass of Jupiter, orbiting in the inner system of the white dwarf, which is a remnant past its red giant phase, and should not have a surviving planet in this position, but it does. Planets can migrate after the red giant phase. There are all sorts of dynamic things that can happen that might move surviving planets around that were once further out. But there is a so-called forbidden zone where anything that might migrate there would not have survived, as far as usual physical processes are involved. Though there is a way for this particular planet to have already been in the process of migrating when the star finished its phase, meaning that this would be a very rare situation of a migrating planet around a white dwarf in action. It's also possible that the red giant phase can push planets out as it happens, which means the sun might push Earth out sufficiently for it to survive, and potentially migrate back inward when the sun reaches its white dwarf stage. Number 3. More Octopus Antics. Longtime viewers of this channel will be aware that I am inordinately fascinated by octopus intelligence, and more has come to light. A species known as the day octopus, common in the Indo-Pacific, hunts by way of wrapping themselves around objects like rocks, and making a kind of trap between their tentacles and the rock to catch small prey. But there was another factor here. The day octopus is solitary, usually, but members of the species have been noted as far back as the 90s to often be accompanied by a congregation of fish. This was initially thought to be opportunistic behavior. The fish were there to capture whatever got away from the octopus, but this has gotten complicated and a bit unsavory. More recent observations have shown that not only do the fish follow the octopus around, the octopus also follows the fish around, meaning that this is not just opportunism on the part of the fish. What seems to be going on is that they are hunting in cooperation, and if a fish sees prey that it can't get to, it swims back and forth, getting the attention of the octopus so they could collaborate to get the prey. Moreover, the octopus has been observed punching other fish to get them away that are not actively helping the hunting cooperation, help or get punched, and somehow all the actual participants involved benefit. The main hunting partner here is the blue goatfish, but there were others, such as the blacktip grouper, which frankly tried but wasn't as good at it as the goatfish, resulting in one observation session where only three useless blue goatfish got punched by an octopus compared to 27 times for the nearby blacktip groupers. Number 2. Mammoths were preferred food for some humans. Artifacts show that about 15,000 years ago, the ice from the last glacial maximum began to retreat, which led humans to migrate across the Bering Strait into North America, and they became the Clovis culture, known from their distinctive stone tools. The tools are known from many widespread sites, but there has only ever been one set of human remains found alongside them. The bones have been reburied, but they were of an 18-month-old boy, and genetically it showed that he was likely an ancestor of today's Native Americans. But the world of the boy's time was very different from today, a post-Ice Age landscape, and it was known that the Clovis people hunted mammoths, but it wasn't known to what extent versus other species from the time that humans hunted. And it turns out, a lot for the mammoth, which there has been some thinking in archaeology that the finely developed stone spear points associated with the Clovis culture were specifically intended for very large animals. Now, isotope ratios from bone collagen from the skeleton of the boy, when looked at in comparison to other predators present in North America during this time, revealed the extent. This type of study is actually very revealing, because diet plays into isotope ratios heavily, and creates profiles. In the case of the skeleton of the young boy, known as Anzac 1, probably strongly reflects his mother's diet, because of mostly milk. But the mammoth markers were very heavily there, indicating that 40%, at least, of his people's diet consisted of mammoth. To put that in perspective, this is a lot more comparable in isotope ratios to a carnivorous saber-toothed cat than it is to an omnivorous bear of the period. Number 1. More Nazca Desert Glyphs Found. The famous Nazca lines need no introduction, making it well into the pop culture, with some even suspecting them of being messages for aliens. Problem being, aliens wouldn't understand them, but in reality they are enormous depictions of lions and birds and many other things in the Peruvian desert that had some cultural or religious driver to create, but they're actually older examples that were not as well preserved or easily identified in past studies that are not well known popularly. And indeed, a new group of them has been recently identified with the help of AI that were not previously known at all. These new images in the desert are older and somewhat smaller and depict a wide range of things from humanoid figures to animals, with some actually suggestive of human sacrifice, such as decapitated heads, as is also shown in Nazca pottery of the period. Curiously, some of this pottery is thought to depict orca whales with large knives cutting off human heads. Perhaps something bad happened in coastal Peru at some point that led the idea of killer whales to a religious sacrifice status. The Nazca Plain still has not been fully mapped, and there are likely even more geoglyphs there, but this single study revealed 303 new ones, and with the area under threat from development, it's probably a good idea to take a look for more sooner rather than later. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently wishing the Ethiopian pollinating wolf and the fish-punching octopus a very fine 2025, along with everyone else. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.